Thank you very much. Congratulations to the organizers of the conference. Very happy to be here. I like the title of the conference very much, so hopefully my presentation will echo it to a degree. Let me begin by quoting from the latest piece by Ivan Kastel and Mark Hermans. In March 2014, they write, Europeans woke up in Vladimir Putin's world, a place as a technical project and underemphasizing its that the EU is not interested in playing geopolitical zero-sum games. This normally would come up in the context of Georgia's troubled relations with Russia. We are post-political adults, post-Italian, almost post-geopolitical. It is therefore not surprising when the EU woke up to the Putin-defined reality in March 2014, it found itself in a very uncomfortable situation. The EU has to react and respond to the behavior it considers to be contrary to its very nature. The EU defines itself as a normative power. It means power with justice and authority and with politics for the pursuit of common security and freedom for the land, not for the pursuit of power and the man itself. It seeks acceptance and compliance with norms and seems to be generated in the foundation of things. The EU, following this logic, has consistently tried to explain to Russia that nothing in the Eastern Partnership or Association Agreement is contrary to Russia's interests, and that strategic partnership with Russia was of great value to the EU. Russia, however, is not convinced. It does not see EU's policies in the neighborhood as benign. For Moscow, association with the EU means disassociation with Russia. Free trade between the Eastern Partnership countries and the EU, as well as alignment of these countries to the European standard of energy regulation, is seen as a threat to the free trade and the economic integration between Russia and the Eastern Partnership countries. Even though the EU refuses to discuss membership perspective for the associated partners, any possible opening of such perspective in the future is now seen as a direct challenge to the Russia-led alternative integration project, such as the Eurasian Union. The current crisis in the EU-Russia relations poses quite a non-trivial dilemma for foreign policy. How to respond to Russia's challenge in a way that A, does not increase confrontation, B, does not jeopardize norms and principles, and C, does not contradict EU's interests in the neighborhood. To resolve three at the same time appears almost impossible. Since politics is the outcome possible, then we need to find the other side of some kind of broad compromise. The question is, can the EU compromise any of the above without compromising itself? This is an important question for us. The kind of response the EU comes up with in this situation will define what kind of international actor the EU is likely to be. This, in turn, will have direct consequences for Europe and for the neighborhood as well. Will the EU pursue containment or engagement, or will it come up with a third way? I often now hear the term for existence used in this context. I don't know exactly what it means. But basically, it's the EU and Russia trying to find a way to understand it. Before doing so, however, I think it's very important that the EU defines clearly what its interests in the region are and how much it is willing to invest in order to pursue them. It is quite clear what Russia's interests are and how much it is ready and how far it is ready to go to defend them. The EU, on the other hand, does not seem to have a clearly defined strategic interest in the region which would be shared by all 28. We also keep talking about the European perspective or the lack of it for this partnership countries, but the EU also needs a perspective on what is an end game of its policy. A policy with poorly defined goals will not only lack ambition, but is also likely to have mixed results. Moreover, we as Georgia also have to understand that despite all the talk about globalization, territorialization, growing interconnectedness, and irrelevance of location, geography in the European context still very much matters. We are the most disadvantaged of the three associated partners when it comes to geography. We do not share border with the EU. We're close to Turkey, which is an obsession of quite some time and likely to remain so. And we're often seen lying outside the European political space. This means that we have to try twice as hard as others, be much more progressive than others, and much more consistent if we want to do geography. This reduces Georgia's pressurized and dismembered. He's trying to get away from the power that he wants it under its influence and towards the power that is ambivalent about it. George has been stuck in the so-called gray zone for quite some time. And living in this gray zone, to quote Hobbes, is solitary, nasty, brutish, and short. No wonder we want to get out of there. The two defining features in this case are contestation and incongruity. I also call it a state of perpetual non-peace, where conflicts are maintained in order to keep leverage to insecurity. In empirical terms, this means continuous vulnerability to the Russian pressure, security deficits heightened by the cases of protracted conflicts with no realistic settlement prospect, no perspective of the EU and NATO membership in the immediate future, and consequently a solid transformation process. Under such conditions of instability and vulnerability, successful transformation is hard to achieve, especially given the lack of powerful incentives. Furthermore, the great out of our control, but it didn't say it was entirely so. We do not